What Hollywood has always loved doing is making a character of its AI intelligences. They're always characters in some sort or another. And in fact, what inevitably happens to a certain degree is sort of Stockholm syndrome sets in. That's to say, is despite how evil they are, that the filmmakers sort of start to fall in love with them. There's more than that in 2001. So enclosed is Kubrick's world, so cold is his world normally, that Hal the computer becomes actually the only character in the film. I mean, the only other person in the film you have any interest in is Leonard Rossiter, who turns up for about 10 minutes in the spaceship. Hal is warm enough that he can be the warmest thing in a Stanley Kubrick film, which is not very warm at all, but it still means he's the most interesting character in the film. Sometimes the personified computers do work reasonably nicely. They're not always evil, but if they're not evil, they tend to be in the background. I'm thinking of entities like Mother in Alien, and more recently Jarvis in the Iron Man films is a classic example of the largely benign in artificial intelligence, which again, in the background, not the center of the film. And interesting, Jarvis in the comics, if I remember correctly, was originally a butler. He was originally a human butler. And that's really what the benign computer is allowed to be in science fiction. He's just, or he or she, for example, mother, lurks around in the background and helps the characters do what they do. The Terminator films gave us Skynet, a machine network that gets angry with us and decides to wipe us all out. And James Cameron did get at something here that you don't get in 2001, and even though the film was made a long time ago, was made a quarter of a century ago, the first film, he already had got something about how computers were changing. What's crucial about Skynet in Terminator is it's a network. And this is something which, again, in 1968, when they made 2001, but hadn't quite grasped. The real danger probably isn't a real danger in that sense, but if there is a real danger, it's more likely to come from a network of computers that begin talking to one another rather than one big monolith that sits there and decides to destroy us like the Mekong in Down Dare. That's probably how it's going to work out. More interesting in terms of evil, though, if we can ascribe evil to computers, which Hollywood does, because again, as I said earlier on, they're all essentially entities of one sort or another, is the Matrix. Because it added, I think, spice to that digital conspiracy by having the machines degrade us in ways that, though less destructive than Terminator, were more insulting than that all-out war. They were ruder. They had worse manners. It's much more personally degrading to be turned into an enormous dream machine than it is to be blandly wiped out. These are the decency to wipe us out. One of the things that Cameron got at, I think, which was quite nicely in that film, was just the insidious rudeness of machines. They just haven't been brought up as well as we have.
The thing I'm most interested in now is, well, if we can get loads of conversations and we can analyze and say, there's good communication, there's bad communication, here's where they're really involved, here's where they're not involved, and then we can model that. So we can just churn through loads and loads of conversations, train up some machine learning algorithms and basically say, give me a model of what's positive.
So I decided to not just make films, but to see if I could explore this opening field of new media and new technology.